Louisville at 11-1, going for their second ever 12-win season, and Miami's just happy to be back in a bowl game and have the NCAA scandal that hampered them for the past couple of years behind them. Also joining us tonight in the booth, a longtime veteran Big Ten official retiring this season, but he'll be helping us out with our rules questions tonight. Bill Lemagne, I would expect, will be joining us more than once as the Russell Athletic Bowl is underway. And the freshman Stacey Coley will bring it out. And barely reaches the 21-yard line. So here's Stephen Morris, the senior, 24 consecutive starts. He stayed with Miami through all the tough times. And that was what Al Golden pointed out to us when we spoke to him about his senior quarterback, that any group with less character might have left or might have abandoned this program through the tough times, but he feels Stephen Morris personifies the group that stayed.
Well, he's a competitor, and he has to harness that and make sure he doesn't go overboard tonight. You know, he and Teddy Bridgewater played Little League Baseball together, and he is definitely interested in showing he can perform as well as Teddy.
They'll start on the ground with Dallas Crawford. And Crawford, of course, getting the start tonight in place of Duke Johnson. If you haven't followed Miami football carefully this season, we'll show you some statistics that will show literally a 180 in their offensive philosophy when they lost their franchise running back.
Yeah, they lost the home run hitter when they lost Duke Johnson, and they've become more reliant on their passing attack since then.
Morris on second down, right up the seam to Clive Walford, and the tight end has a first down out to about the 38.
Yeah, there is Duke Johnson, almost 1,000 yards rushing this season, and for the home run, he had 28 attempts where he got at least 10 yards.
Lost for the season in the game against Florida State. Morris looking for the home run ball down the sideline. No chance to get to Allen Hurns. But a flag comes out. Charles Gaines back in coverage.
Well, you know, the question is whether you impeded the receiver. If you hold, grab, keep him from getting to the ball, then that's typically when you'll get the attention.
Pass interference, defense, number 3. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
And Charles Gaines is a little bit worked up about that. You see the end of it here. There's an arm bar. He uses his left arm. Not a lot of contact, but that left arm came out to kind of slow down the receiver, and that was Allen Hurns over there.
In the absence of Duke Johnson, this has not only become a passing attack for Miami, but a deep ball home run hitting passing attack. And that shot taken by Stephen Morris gets them a flag and a first down.
They'll take 9 or 10 shots a game down the field.
That might loosen things up for Dallas Crawford as well, but nothing there on first down. Maybe a yard. Brandon Dunn made the stop.
We're talking about Duke Johnson being out, and so Dallas Crawford stepped in, got his opportunity. They've also used Gus Edwards, who's a freshman running back, and he's probably their most talented guy. You know, big guy, 225 pounds. But the real focus has been the screen game and using the wide receivers.
Edwards on second down. Gets straight. Kept the play alive to the 40-yard line. 3 yards shy of a first down. It will be 3rd down and 3.
You know, I mentioned the screen game and that the receivers are so important for these guys. And Stacey Coley is a guy who's really, really critical in the screen game. Short pass, great yards after the catch. They get him the ball and let him go. Now, the other side, you've got Hurns, who's the MVP of the team. He's more of the mid-range deep threat.
Hurns a senior, Coley a true freshman. Normally a sure-handed senior drops one on third down, and Miami will have to punt. So Pat O'Donnell will kick it deep. Eli Rogers, Miami Northwestern grad, who was a high school teammate of Teddy Bridgewater, part of a four-man group that came from Northwestern to Louisville. And the end-over-end kick spins down to about the one-yard line. Pat O'Donnell doing his best Sergio Garcia impersonation. Just spun a wedge to the one.
Yeah, use the wedge, a little backspin on that thing. Kind of like one of your golf shots.
Normally, that's with driver. Not good in that case, but very good if you want to pin a team deep. However, if you have an offense in this kind of an atmosphere, pinned back at your own two-yard line for the first snap of the night, who better to have a quarterback than maybe the best quarterback in college football?
I think that's one of his greatest skills, factors, is that he just doesn't panic. He handles pressure really well. Whether it's being backed up, whether it is being blitzed, he just keeps his composure.
You see him walk out there with a little bop in his step. He plays with the swagger of a guy that knows he's the best on the field. They'll start on the ground with Dominique Brown. And Brown gets to the four-yard line. It will be second down and eight. Thurston Armbrister made first contact for the U.
When you study Teddy Bridgewater and you talk to scouts, the same things come up. Decision-making, skill, ball handling. He's able to fake with the football. He takes care of the football. Doesn't panic back there.
Bridgewater from the end zone. Under pressure. Down he goes. It's a safety.
Teddy Bridgewater did not see Deion Bush on the blitz. He sneaks in, and there's a safety. Miami up 2-0. Here, Bush is about 13 yards deep, and then when Teddy looks back, he looks away from him, Bush is free to come. And Teddy Bridgewater had no idea. He didn't expect a guy that deep to come on a blitz. Deion Bush with an excellent disguise.
So not only does the U have the 2-0 lead, but they're about to get the football back off the safety. Coley from the 11. A true freshman that can fly if he gets in the open field. Tried to cut and lost his footing at the 35. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Game-changing superior performance when it counts. Goodyear, more driven. And we love that last look as we saw the safety blitz of Deion Bush from the blip. Gave us a perfect look. If only Teddy Bridgewater had that angle in front of him, maybe he would have recognized that it was coming. And how much heat does that now take off of Stephen Morris? Great field position, the early lead, and it's Bridgewater that makes the first mistake.
Yeah, well, you know, James Coley, the offensive coordinator, told me that he has to talk to and stay on Stephen Morris. He's a competitor, but he wants him to harness his emotions.
Gus Edwards for 3 yards.
You know, Coley, the offensive coordinator, he was at Florida State, had E.J. Manuel there, and talking to him before the game, he says, you know, Morris has every bit the arm that E.J. Manuel had. E.J. Manuel's a first-round pick.
Edwards again. Met at the 40-yard line. And may have worked out about 2.5. Preston Brown made the stop for Louisville. So a chance for the Cardinals defense to get a stop after the safety and the free kick on third down and a short five.
They've got to find Pryor, number 25. They figure, where is Pryor? He's a strong safety that makes a lot of plays, particularly on third down.
Louisville dancing around trying to disguise their look. No one down in a three-point stance. Can Stephen Morris figure out where the Cardinals are coming from with three on the play clock? Here comes the blitz. He's in trouble. And down goes Morris. Preston Brown gets the sack.
all that standing around confused them. You know, Brown is the middle linebacker, but they move him around, particularly on third down pressure situations, and he's over here, and they don't account for him. You've got a back set to that side. It looks like Clemens, 23, moves away and then comes inside. He does not stay outside to pick up. Protection wasn't geared to pick up Brown coming from the edge.
Louisville almost got a punt block. Instead, it's a line drive that takes a sideways hop out of bounds. And it will be Cardinals ball at about their own 26-yard line after a 44-yard punt that Pat O'Donnell did well just to get away. That's big for the Louisville defense as they get a three and out after the safety, and now a little breathing room for their offense as the Buffalo Wild Wings bowl will come up later on tonight here on ESPN as Michigan with a different quarterback tonight taking on Kansas State.
Yeah, no Devin Gardner for them. Going with the freshman.
Sonoris Perry to the 27-yard line. That's a gain of a yard. Olson Pierre made the stop. It'll be second down and long.
You know, Shu, a lot of these guys, you know, grew up playing peewee football together, played high school football against each other, so there's bound to be a little bit of little trash talk, little extracurricular activity.
A strike thrown to the sideline by Bridgewater on the move, and that's good for a Louisville first down.
Pretty nice, huh?
Found Devontae Parker right up against the chalk, and that'll move the chains.
You know, scouts will pull this up and look at it. He's rolling to his left, away from his throwing hand, and he still squares his shoulders right on the money. And that's the kind of stuff that he does effortlessly that you go, yeah, I kind of like that kid.
On the play clock as Bridgewater hands to Dominique Brown. He gets shut down. He might have lost a step. Second down and long coming up for Louisville.
You know, the last half of the season, teams just ran all over Miami's defense. They got hit an awful lot. And Louisville certainly believed that they could run to the edge.
Bridgewater finds the soft spot in the zone. Perfectly thrown to Damian Copeland for a first down and a big play to the Miami 42-yard line. That's a gain of 21.
Miami tends to play a lot of quarters defense, four guys deep, and they also play a lot of three guys deep. And so there are holes in those zones. Jameis Winston found a lot of that.
I was going to say, when you watch tape, you mentioned Florida State as being the team that really exploited that.
Yeah, they really worked the inside, the linebackers, and the strong safeties using their slot receivers.
Then all of a sudden you come up and press man to react, and then what happens?
Take a shot down the field.
Let's see if Miami in any way adjusts, and if Bridgewater starts to look down the field. Play action here. Dumps one underneath. There's the patience. The check down to Dominique Brown. And that's another first down.
You are so right. I mean, that's the thing that people talk about, scouts talk about. Teddy Bridgewater doesn't force the ball down the field. You know, what's the old saying? You can't go broke taking a profit. Well, there's a profit just dumping the ball to Gerald Christensen, the tight end, instead of trying to drill it down the field where you might not get it.
Teddy Bridgewater already 3 for 3, 47 yards on this drive. So already a response to the safety on the opening possession for Louisville as the Cardinals are within striking distance. Brown inside the 25 for a gain of two.
Well, the Miami answer to their problems against run defense the last half of the year is to get the secondary involved. And they brought Smith that time. Hi, Smith, from the edge. You saw Deion Bush blitz earlier. So they're trying to shore up the edges by using their safeties to blitz.
Bridgewater tries to extend the play, and does, and finds a man. Devontae Parker came back to help out his quarterback. That's a five-yard gain.
And Parker's
looked
down.
Like it could have been a big loss, and that would be a big loss if Devontae Parker's injured. That's the leading receiver for Louisville.
He's a first-team, all-conference receiver, a guy that could come out this season if he wants to. You see Bridgewater. Here's Parker at the end. He was projected earlier by scouts preseason to be a second or third round pick. He has not said anything about coming out, but he's down right now.
We'll step aside while Devontae Parker is checked out. U.S. Special Ops Command parachute team delivered the U flag, the UL flag, and the game ball before tonight's game, and got the Russell Athletic Bowl crowd fired up. A big third down coming here for Louisville. Down 2-0 after the opening safety, but Teddy Bridgewater has been just about flawless this year on third down.
He's been great. He's got a 90 QBR quarterback rating, 50s average, so he's almost perfect.
Looks end zone on third down, incomplete. Michael Lee Harris, another Miami native, was the intended receiver. But it will be fourth down and a field goal try to give Louisville the lead.
That's a good stop for the Miami defense after the way that Bridgewater moved them down the field, for forcing that third down and then coming up with a stop there.
So it's the sophomore, John Wallace. 17 of 21 so far this season. His long of 45 for his career, 39 this year. This from 36 yards away. And that gives Louisville the one-point lead.
Three-run homer took the lead, huh?
Made up for that two-run double they gave up in the first. Back to Orlando in a moment. Bob Ischusen, Rod Gilmore, and Quinn Kesnick here in Orlando. And you think about Miami as well, Rod, being back in a bowl game. Now, they were as high as seventh in the BCS. They went to Florida State with a chance to compete for the national championship.
Yeah.
So there were, at times this season, grander expectations than the Russell Athletic Bowl. Having said that, this has to be considered a really good building block year for this program.
Absolutely.
As they finally have the NCAA scandal in the rearview mirror, and Al Golden has this program back on track.
Yeah, they're not quite back, but they're really close, and right now it looks like they're going to have a top five recruiting class next year, and you put that with all the guys coming back, if the U isn't back, it's getting really, really close to being back.
Coley from 5 yards deep will bring it out. Knocked down at the 25, out to about the 27-yard line. More on Miami's program in a moment after we have our first chance to say hello to Reese Davis.
Hello, Bob. This instant replay is brought to you by the new Surface Belt Bowl, North Carolina and Cincinnati. This is true freshman Ryan Switzer. This 86-yard punt return for a touchdown, fifth of the season, that ties an FBS record, and he's just three away from the all-time career record, and he's got 3 years to get it. Carolina won easily over Cincy.
Reese, we've got a one-point game early here in Orlando, and a ball batted down by the American Conference Defensive Player of the Year, Marcus Smith.
Yeah, 6'3", 260 pounds. Watch him get up and knock this one down. Who would ever guess he was a former quarterback?
He originally came to Louisville as a quarterback.
Yeah.
Threw a few in the dirt. They said, why don't you try defense? He's going to end up in the NFL as a defensive player.
Yeah, he is a pass rushing specialist.
Might be a neutral zone infraction and a free play for Morris, who takes a shot down the sideline. Stepping out of bounds, then coming back in with Stacy Coley. But it looked as if Louisville jumped off sides.
Pass intended for number three, Coley.
Offside. Defense, number 94. 5-yard penalty. Replay second down.
Rod, we talked to Al Golden about what we were talking about a moment ago. He really put it in perspective. His 3 years. He said, we came under the auspices of rebuilding the program. Then it became about saving the program. We're on the cover of SI saying we should drop the program. And now here we are in a bowl game with all of that behind us. Another flag at the snap, as again in the neutral zone, jumping off sides is Louisville.
You think? That was pretty clear.
Defense offside, unabated to the quarterback, number 92. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, don't get me started about the NCAA and the way they handled Miami. I think, personally, it was outrageous what they did, and there was no reason this program should have had more sanctions thrown on them than what they imposed, you know, they self-imposed.
You understand I've worked with you now this entire year. My goal is to get you started on something like that. First down handoff, and not too much for Dallas Crawford.
Well, you know, Teddy Bridgewater is a good example. I mean, he said that he was interested in Miami, but then when they fired Randy Shannon and they had issues, he thought the program was going downhill and he needed to move away. And so he came to Louisville. Well, there are a lot of guys like that that Golden would love to have. Never got a shot.
Morris to the outside. That's a hard hit right on the sideline. Walter Tucker hauled it in. Now check that Walford. He was popped by Champ Lee.
Champ Lee is in for George Durant. That's a good hit. That's not a helmet-to-helmet or targeting shot. Good chance to try to wrap up. Brings up a big third down.
Third and five. They throw the screen to the freshman Coley. Reaches the ball out about a yard shy of the first down. A terrific tackle by Hakeem Smith. Yeah, that will force a punt.
You need not be surprised. Hakeem Smith is one of the best open field tacklers in college football. He's playing the free safety spot after having played the strong safety spot for years, but he is a sure tackler. That's why they have him back there.
Stephen Morris in the offense staying on the field. Fourth down and one on your half of the field. We've already seen Louisville jump off sides twice on this possession.
Yeah,
is this just a hard count? Are they going to run the play? Hand it to Gus Edwards. He's got nowhere to go. Louisville gets a fourth down stop. An early risk by Miami becomes turnover on downs.
Yeah, I thought that was a little risky early in your own territory and Teddy Bridgewater on the other side. How about the play that Marcus Smith made to take away the edge? He forced everything back inside, allowed the pursuit to come from the inside, but it was Marcus Smith on the outside that stuffed it, caused everything back inside. You think Charlie Strong liked it?
Charlie Strong told us this is a measuring stick program type game for us. Make no mistake, we're in this conference against these guys next year. This shows us how we measure up.
And don't underestimate the battle for the city of Miami. And they both recruit that city. And that's going to become even more imperative as they face each other in the ACC starting next season.
Play action for Bridgewater. Long throw to the sideline, bobbled, and incomplete. It is ruled incomplete. Damian Copeland couldn't hold on, and Quint Kesnick's down on the field. Quint.
Cardinals operating without one of their top wide receivers right now. Devontae Parker has been taken to the locker room. Remember that last series, he hurt his right ankle. They brought him over to the sideline. They retaped it. They spatted it. He jogged behind the bench with that athletic trainer Kyle Johnson. Really didn't do much cutting, was still in pain, so they took him inside.
He's their big play guy, no question. 11 touchdowns this season, 27 touchdowns for his career, and he's only a junior.
Well, that's a huge, huge loss. It impacts the Miami defense.
Second down and 10. Four-man rush. Right up the seam it goes to Michael Lee Harris. Miami Northwestern to Miami Northwestern against the Miami defense. And a Louisville first down.
Yeah, you know, working against the slot, against that soft zone coverage we talked about, just like Jameis Winston did, it's exactly what Teddy Bridgewater is doing. Now, You know, the one thing I mentioned about Parker being out, Miami planned to double him, to roll their coverage his way. But since they don't have to do that now, they can play more straight up and then take away guys like Rodgers on the inside.
You feel great for Michael Lee Harris to make some catches tonight as well with all he's been through. Hand off to Dominique Brown. He gets stood up. Fumba Kamalu makes the stop for Miami. And there's Michael Lee Harris. He's a redshirt junior. Why is he a redshirt? Well, think about the injury problems he's been through. He hadn't caught a pass since 2011 before this season. Torn ACL, torn MCL, pardon me, in 2010. Then he tore the ACL in both of his knees. His right knee at the end of 2011 and just before the 2012 season in his left knee. Finally now this year, able to play once again. Bridgewater wants the home run. Incomplete. Overthrew Ryan Hubbell, the tight end.
Yeah, too strong. Had him out there. He just had to give it a little air and let Hubbell go get it, and it was too strong.
Now that brings up third down and 10.
Yeah, you know, and now you wonder, do they roll the dice and bring some pressure? Because Teddy Bridgewater has been really, really good on third down and really good against the blitz. Miami has had some success blitzing him tonight, but will they roll the dice down here now?
False start. It'll be third and 15.
False start. Offense, number 74. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Already the fourth Louisville penalty. Now it's third down and 15.
Yeah, they may have to pick up something here because I'm not sure they can make a field goal from this range.
Well, John Wallace's career long is 45 yards, and this would be about a 50-yarder from here.
Yeah, they may need to think about getting five or six instead of trying to pick up the first down here.
Five-man rush. Bridgewater steps up. The patience again to set up the field goal. He comes underneath the Sonoris Perry, takes what he can get, and makes it a much more manageable kick for John Wallace.
Well, Miami played coverage. There was nothing deep. And they only rushed four. They dropped seven, and there was nothing deep to be had. So Bridgewater, you know, as you said, was patient and took the check down.
I think that's what, in many ways, makes him even that much more attractive to NFL scouts, right? I mean, that's the kind of throw and the kind of play that wins you NFL games. You don't get oftentimes the pinball machine numbers in the NFL. Field goals mean a lot. This one from 43. A knuckleball that finds its way through.
Well, you see how picking up those few yards helps you get some points.
We'll step aside for 60 seconds and come right back to Orlando. Two over Miami. So two for two to start the game, John Wallace. And Miami about to get the football back.
Number 45, John Wallace, free ball for the Cardinals. Number one, number three, Stacy Foley for Miami.
Wallace kicking off for the fourth time here in the first quarter. Stacy Coley again brings it out. This time he bounces outside, gets tripped up. That is a nice tackle and an important one by Robert Clark, the wide receiver. Well, Monday, Capital One Bowl Week has you covered with an all-day marathon of college football. And Oregon, Texas, Rod Gilmore certainly jumps out. That's the Valero Alamo Bowl and the last game of Texas for Mack Brown.
Well, not only Mack Brown leaving, but also Nick Aliotti, the defensive coordinator for Oregon, longtime coordinator. Both of those guys, Class A great coaches, and that game's going to be emotional for those players because of both of those coaches leaving the game.
Dallas Crawford for 4 yards on first down.
Number 10 for Miami.
So Miami took the 2-0 lead on the safety, and they have done little offensively. They only have 30 total yards, 4 yards rushing, and it was those 4 yards that Dallas Crawford just picked up that gets them on the plus side in terms of rushing. They were 0 yards on their first 8 carries against this Louisville defensive front.
Yeah, but I think Stephen Morris has been smart. He hasn't forced it, you know? I think that's the right way to go.
Morris flushed out of the pocket. And he'll throw it away.
You know, that's another example of a good, smart play. I mean, these are the types of things that people had questions about with Morris, but you saw that. Had nothing there. He would go, showed you his athleticism getting away from it, and then threw the ball away to come back and play third down. That's smart quarterbacking.
Well, Louisville and Michigan State are the only two schools in the country to be top 8 in total defense, scoring defense, rushing defense, and passing defense. But you wonder how much of that for Louisville has to do with playing in the American Conference.
Yeah, well, this is where the issue has been for Miami all season. Third down, they struggled.
Morris looking for the home run ball to double coverage. It might have been picked off. Hakeem Smith had it. Did he get a foot down inbounds? And it looks like the officials will say incomplete pass that Hakeem Smith landed out of bounds, so Miami will punt.
Well, this is what we talk about forcing it. This was forced. When you watch Louisville play, you know, their safety, Hakeem Smith, plays about 20 yards deep. It's hard to get a deep ball because he's already so deep, he can go to the sideline. He can make that play. And that's a case of Morris forcing one where he shouldn't have. That's what James Coley, the offensive coordinator, is telling him.
Louisville almost got to Pat O'Donnell and blocked his last punt. And they've got 10 players right up near the line. This time they'll set up a return, and O'Donnell will angle one to the sideline, and it is a terrific kick. And we'll take a hop. And we'll be touched up at about the 16-yard line. That is a magnificent change of field position punt by Pat O'Donnell, 56 yards. Well, Louisville, they've only lost one game so far this season, and it was back in October when they took on UCF. They had a 28-7 lead with 7:52 to go in the third quarter, and it came apart as the Knights scored 31 points in the last 23 minutes and beat Louisville 38-35. And at the time, you thought that Louisville was going to be the team, not UCF, to make it to the BCS, and they were ranked highly enough that if the losses took place in front of them, not out of the realm of possibility, they might have had an argument for the national championship game.
Yeah, and that game kept Teddy Bridgewater from becoming the all-conference first-team quarterback as well. Got him out of that Heisman race, too.
Miami might have jumped off sides, and they get a big stop in the backfield. That was a head start, though. Curtis Porter made the tackle, but it looked like Anthony Ciccolo might have jumped. So we'll have to get the call.
Offside defense, number 71. 5-yard penalty, replay first down.
Well, this defense has done a terrific job of handling Louisville's rushing attack. And it's surprising because, as I mentioned earlier, they really struggled to handle the run the last half of the season.
Bridgewater into a tight window for a first down. And holding out of the football is Michael Lee Harris while the Canes try and rip it away. Is that a confident throw?
Oh, man. You have to really know you can squeeze it to get this one in here. I mean, talk about confidence. Oh, boy.
Louisville may get one more playoff before the end of the quarter. And they do, and it's Bridgewater on a keeper. The seas part for Teddy Bridgewater, who slides to midfield. A 16-yard scramble for Teddy Bridgewater to end the first down on the field. In 2010, 16-year-old Dylan Rebior lost his 8-month battle with colon cancer just hours before his Columbia, Tennessee high school team won their first state championship in 58 years. It was actually the subject of a Tom Rinaldi piece on ESPN. Dylan's mother, Heather, along with Russell Athletic, created the Fight Like Dylan Award. And this year's recipient, Buena Vista, Colorado, whose football team made a great run in the state playoffs, overcoming the tragic loss of assistant coach Dwayne Johnson and his wife and three other family members in a rock slide. The Fight Like Dylan Award recognizes a high school and community that demonstrates perseverance through sports. And Buena Vista, Colorado, a very deserving recipient, as Coach Johnson's mother was down on the field to receive that award while we were away. Teddy Bridgewater, 7 of 10 for 84 yards, and capping the first quarter with a 16-yard scramble. And we start the second quarter with the Cardinals near midfield. Dominique Brown takes a pop right at midfield, spinning forward for a yard and a half.
Neither team has been able to amount much of a rushing attack. Both teams doing a great job of taking away the edge. Miami using the secondary to support and take that away.
And Miami struggled to stop the run this season, 12th in the ACC against the run. That ball batted down at the line. It'll be third down and a long eight. As coming through to knock it down was Olsen Pierre.
You know, things are a little bit tougher for Miami with Devontae Parker out. Top receiver, and when you take him out, now you don't have to double any receiver. And he's the guy that Miami was most concerned about. Their defense is a lot more confident. They can play more coverages. They free up more guys because Parker and his threat are out of the game right now. It's a bad ankle.
We were told he might return, but you could see he's walking with a limp over on the sideline. So without their best receiver, Louisville facing third down and a long eight. Bridgewater sets up the screen. That's good for a first down and more. Damian Copeland to the Miami 30. Well-designed play by the Cardinals, and it picks up 20 yards.
Well, they caught him with the pressure coming, and they got the screen pass right beyond it. Copeland did a great job of running after the catch, but you see the pressure, a little twist, and the linebacker's coming, and Copeland's right there to take advantage of it.
Another keeper for Bridgewater. Tripped up, but picks up seven. It'll be second down and three. Antonio Crawford cut him down.
You don't see a lot of that with Louisville during the season with Teddy Bridgewater carrying the football and design runs. You think maybe they're thinking, well, if he's leaving, we're going to use him.
He only ran for 54 net yards during the season.
Yeah.
Dropped by the tight end. Ryan Hubble couldn't haul it in inside the 20-yard line. It will be third down and three after we check in with Quinn.
Bob, I remember when Teddy was at Miami Northwestern High School, he was considered a dual-threat quarterback. Their option in high school was a lot of read. He carried the ball a lot, but they've made him a pocket passer here at Louisville. Tonight, maybe a different story.
He's also gained about 30 pounds since coming to Louisville. Still slender by NFL standards for a quarterback. Third down and three. Right at the first down marker.
That's a good tackle.
And we'll have to see where Sonoris Perry is marked down. It looks like he'll be a half yard shy. So a decision now for Charlie Strong. Take the three or go forward on fourth down and a foot.
Yeah, Muhammad did a great, great job with that tackle. Yeah, and I think Charlie Strong's going to go for this. You watch the way that Muhammad wraps him up over there, and that creates the fourth and short. Given how much trouble they've had running the football, I wouldn't be confident of running it other than having Teddy Bridgewater get something done for me out of that read option.
Lamar Atkins, the fullback, Sonoris Perimeter, Dominique Brown is the tailback. They'll run it with Brown. Flags down. He's got the first down and then some. He's inside the 10-yard line if the play stands. But we'll have to check the penalty marker thrown back at the line. Also, Thurston Armbrister, outside linebacker for Miami, is injured.
Illegal formation. Offense. 5 men in the backfield. 5-yard penalty. Replay fourth down.
Well, that changes your thinking.
And here comes the field goal group.
Five guys in the backfield. Count them all.
You got your two receivers, the quarterback, and the two running backs. Yeah, that's not going to get it done if you're Louisville. So now it's fourth down and six. And that will bring John Wallace on, who's already 2 for 2. This one from 42. Right down the middle. John Wallace is now 3 for 3. And Louisville has done a good job of shaking off the early safety. They've got a 9-2 lead. Field, but they have held the Miami offense down, and a big reason why, of course, UM doesn't have their best player in Duke Johnson.
Yeah, he is the long ball hitter. He gives you the ability to score from anywhere on the field. He's not been a part of it. He suffered a broken ankle against Florida State, and the big play from the rushing attack went away. Now, you add to that Herb Waters, wide receiver, starter, who's been out. He got hurt in practice and hasn't suited up for this ball game, so a couple of key guys missing for Miami.
Short kick to the 10-yard line. Coley sets his team up with pretty good field position, just shy of the 30-yard line, but Miami has done nothing with the football for the most part.
Yeah, well, you know, they've got, 30 yards on 15 plays. The scoring is from a safety, punt, over on downs, and then a couple more punts. Now, I think Stephen Morris throws a great deep ball, but it's hard to do that against Louisville.
After the play was over, personal foul. Kicking team number 45. 15-yard penalty will be added on to the end of the run. First down.
Well, not only is that a dead ball after the play foul, but it's against the kicker. John Wallace called for a 15-yard foul. That came after the play was over and is going to give Miami the ball just shy of midfield.
And you know what the teammates and coaches are saying? Just kick the ball. Just kick the ball.
Six Louisville penalties, and this one gives a little life to UM. Under pressure, Morris, he'll go down. No chance to get away from Champ Lee.
Yeah, Champ Lee is in for George Durant, who's not made the trip, not starting. He violated team rules, and Champ Lee, senior, gets the start. Just uses his quickness to jump by Eric Flowers and makes the play. Now, it's hard to get the ball deep. When you look at the safeties for Louisville, in particular, Hakeem Smith, he lines up about 20, 22 yards deep.
Screen to the freshman. That's good for 5 yards as Stacy Coley gets back out to the 40-yard line, but it will be third down and 15 for a Miami offense that now has negative 6 yards rushing and only 25 yards of total offense.
Hey, take a look right there. That's your safety. Look how far back Hakeem Smith is going. That's why you can't throw the ball deep down the field, because he stays in the middle and that ball hangs in the air near the sideline and he can go over and make a play. Nobody in college football plays their safety as deep as Louisville.
Play clock at 2. 5-man rush coming. Morris running for his life again, throws it to the sideline and throws it away. Only a 5-man rush, and Morris on 3rd and 15 still was not able to even plant his feet and look downfield.
Yeah, it's
and
a sieve up there.
Doesn't seem very happy with the protection.
It's a sieve up there right now. And that defensive front, there's not a whole lot of trickeration going up, not a lot of stunting. I mean, they're beating their guys.
You can make an argument that for Miami, the only points scored tonight, basically scored by Pat O'Donnell. The punter has been busy. His punt down to the 1 yard line set up the safety, and this one goes into the end zone. It was really special teams that set up the only points that UM has been able to score here in the first half. The story has been the Louisville defense. Who to root for? Either way, Coach Nellenberger comes out a winner.
Yeah, but which party does it go to?
The winner. 9-2. Louisville has the lead and the ball. Teddy Bridgewater outside, coming back to make the catch and making a nice move down the sideline is Devontae Parker. So he's back in the game off the ankle injury.
I think that ankle's not so bad. I mean, he gives a nice little shake over there to Artie Burns and makes him miss. I mean, if that's a bad ankle, give me two.
Hand off to Sonoris Perry. He's close to a first down. To about the 44-yard line. Now, we needed to find basically security video to find the penalty on the kicker, John Wallace.
There he is,
number
right
45.
There.
Now, we don't normally have cameras 3 or 4 seconds after a play's over, isolating the kicker. But there's the penalty on John Wallace.
Yeah, he took a swing. He doesn't know the rule. It's always the second guy. And he was the second guy.
We had to go to the blimp to find that penalty.
Good deal.
On John Wallace. It gave Miami great field position, but they did nothing with it. And now after a couple of plays, Louisville facing second down and one, but they are almost back out to midfield. Perry again. He's got a first down. Drives his way to the 50-yard line for a gain of 6. Capital One Bowl Week continues tonight. The first ever gridiron matchup between Michigan and Kansas State. It's the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl from Tempe here on ESPN at 10:15 Eastern, also live on Watch ESPN.
I'm definitely curious to see how Michigan reacts with Devin Gardner out.
Bridgewater on a rollout. Away from the pressure, underneath. Lamar Atkins made the catch, took a heavy hit right to the quad, but went down after a gain of about 5. Thurston Armbruster came over and cut down Lamar Atkins.
Yeah, he doesn't see this coming.
Ouch.
That's a good solid tackle at the thighs. Tries to wrap up. Armbruster with a good tackle, good clean play.
Just worry about a player's knee in that situation. If that knee looked like it bent in the wrong direction. Second down and 6. Here comes a blitz. Bridgewater fires a strike for a first down, and it's Devontae Parker.
You know, we talked about Bridgewater just not getting bothered, not frustrated by a blitz. I mean, he just gets it picked up. He knows where he wants to go with the football. It's right on time. As soon as he gets his receiver, Parker, turning around, the ball is there. That's a good timed route.
Well, Sean Watson told us Devontae Parker is their go-to guy. He is as good a wide receiver as he's ever been around in 32 years in coaching. And their offense looks different when he's on the field. Dominique Brown. Another good first down play. Second down and 3 coming up for Louisville.
You mentioned Sean Watson. Are you as intrigued and surprised as I am about the relationship that he has with Teddy Bridgewater? I'm blown away by the fact that those two guys, I mean, they get choked up talking about each other.
Well, Teddy Bridgewater told us yesterday, walking off the field after practice, that you've got those 3, 4, 5 people in your life that are that close to you. That's your nucleus. He included Sean Watson, the play caller, in that group. Yeah, those two are attached at the hip. Bridgewater looks off the coverage, has a man-for-man option in the end zone, throws it up, and who makes the play for him? Devontae Parker for the touchdown. What a bounce back by Louisville since the safety. Miami had all the momentum in the opening moments. It was 2-0 Canes. Now it's 16-2.
Sooner or later, Teddy will get you. And they got him there. Parker going up. The big grab.
This touchdown grab. Miami's got 25 total yards of offense for the game.
Yeah.
And midway through the second quarter, it's a dominant performance thus far for Louisville.
Yeah, yeah, they've covered it all. I mean, the only mistake was the safety to start the game.
Line drive kick. Coley brings it out from about the goal line, gets to the sideline, and a pretty good return. And some pushing and shoving after the whistle away from the play, but terrific quarterback play by Bridgewater.
Yeah, let's watch the matchup he wants here. He's got single coverage. He knows he's got man free. The safety is free there. I want you to watch how Teddy Bridgewater moves the safety here. We stop right there. Look what he does. He's looking here. He's going to move the safety over there, and that's going to open up the outside. No chance for the safety to come back and make a play. He can throw it down the seam to his receiver. And that's great quarterback play, just moving the safety out of the way.
Stephen Morris under the gun now, just about throws a pick. Charles Gaines jumped that route, read it, but just couldn't quite get there to turn it over. It'll be second down and 10.
Be careful with Gaines. He is a guy that has scored three touchdowns three different ways, kick return, punt return, and a pick six. And how fast is he? He says, I'm the fastest on this team. I run with animals.
Five interceptions this year for Charles Gaines. Now it's to the ground. Right up the middle, breaking a tackle, and that's a big run for Dallas Crawford. That is what Miami needed.
Yeah.
A first down and a chance to get a little rhythm going on offense.
Yeah, prior to that play, they were really, really struggling. They were awful on first down, seven first down plays. They had minus 2 yards. On this second down play, Crawford breaks a couple tackles. He's got deceptive power. Not a big guy, but he is quick and powerful.
Crawford again. Room again for 7 yards across the 50 for Miami. Calvin Pryor came up to make the tackle.
You're talking about a guy in Dallas Crawford who started out as a defensive back on the scout team, got moved to wide receiver and ultimately special teams before finding himself at the running back spot. And he stepped in for Duke Johnson after Johnson got hurt.
Well, Al Golden told us that he's one of those guys every coach hopes he'll find. Here he is again. This time he is waffled behind the line. James Burgess comes through to make the tackle for a loss of a couple. It'll be third down and 5.
Burgess is usually the guy that they keep back and let him roll over to make plays. He doesn't blitz very often, but man, that's a good tackle. Wrapped up, got him up high, wrapped him up completely.
That was a poor man's Jadeveon Clowney.
You like that, huh?
Third down and 5. Roll out for Morris. Rifles it underneath. That should have been picked off. Hakeem Smith came that close, or check that. Terrell Floyd came that close to what very well could have been a pick six. So one first down for Miami. They get the ball to midfield, but they have to punt again.
They've got nothing going. And you know, one of the things that stands out to me, the screen game, which is so critical for Miami's offense, gone. They haven't been able to get anything out of it.
And now the officials have stopped play. There may have been a flag throw. There was.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Defense.
Wow.
Number 3. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Well, that's against, I believe, the true freshman, Stacy Coley. Quint Kesnick is down there. Quint?
Charles Gaines, Louisville, basically taunting and walking up and down the Miami sideline, really kind of instigated. The official was right there and called him for a foul. There was no reason for him to spend all that time in front of the Miami sideline. He was looking for a fight. He got a foul.
Yeah, pardon me, I had the wrong team. So Gaines gives Miami a free first down.
Yeah, they got to take advantage of this. And Quint's absolutely right. Gaines is high energy, likes to talk out there. Pretty confident player.
Here comes the blitz. Morris well protected. Down the sideline, he's got the tight end Wofford. Inside the 10, first and goal for the U.
They got the matchup with Brown, the linebacker, and that's one they talked to us about all week that they'd like to have. If they could get Brown, who's 260 pounds at linebacker, matched up with Wofford, the tight end, and Wofford's a guy who's going to play in the NFL. He's considering coming out early, and he just blew right by Brown.
Dallas Crawford up the middle to about the 5-yard line, and Dallas Crawford did a great job on blitz pickup on that last play as the extra rusher didn't get there. And that gave Stephen Morris the time to find Clive Wofford.
How big was that penalty by Gaines? He's not bashful.
Morris, the ball stripped out. Marcus Smith knocked it out. And it's a turnover.
There's Marcus Smith. He's just going to come from the outside there. And he's lined up over the tight end. Nobody picks him up. You see the slip there by Crawford, who tried to get to him. And Morris had no clue. And that ball's in a precarious position. Now watch him go high. That's a guy who has perfected that NFL move of trying to strip the football.
Brandon Dunn recovered the fumble. So Marcus Smith, the American Defensive Player of the Year, the first Louisville Defensive Player of the Year since Elvis Dumervil won the job in the Big East back in 2005. The third sack. It's a takeaway, and Miami first and goal, and they come away empty. And now they'll go Wildcat as Teddy Bridgewater splits out to the near side right. Direct snap to Dominique Brown. Looking for some room and stood up shy of the 15. A gain of maybe a yard and a half.
You think Gaines might go over to Smith and say thanks, partner, bailing me out after that personal foul?
The last four Louisville possessions all have crossed the 50. Miami has forced second down and long inside the 15. Bridgewater rolls out. It's bobbled and dropped. Robert Clark couldn't hold on. So now a big chance for the Miami defense on third down and a long 8.
Yeah, that's a good job by Miami. Louisville ran a pick play there. Man coverage, and they just ran off one of the defenders, got away with it, but couldn't hang on to the ball. Good adjustment by Miami to fight as hard as they could to get through that. Can you tell I was the victim of a few pick plays?
You sound bitter.
A little.
Yeah. It's not the first time that bitterness has crept out. I'll say it's ugly.
Yeah. Receivers say that they're crafty. I just say it's nasty.
Bridgewater trying to get his team set. Play clock at 4. Play clock down to 1, and he has to call timeout. So we'll step aside.
Louisville.
Can Miami get the football back and have a chance to score before halftime? Louisville has dominated off at the Russell Athletic Bowl. Under 4 minutes to go in the first half. And a huge play for Miami, trying to get off the field on defense, 3 and out. After the turnover by their offense. Teddy Bridgewater out of the shotgun. 4 receivers. Throws it over the middle, right at the first down marker. And it will be a yard short to Eli Rogers. So Miami will force the punt, and they'll get the ball back with their timeouts.
Well, they needed that stop, and they need to have a shot at getting on the board before halftime. and this ought to give them relatively decent field position. And they'll have just over 3 minutes, or about 3 minutes, to try and get into the end zone.
Ryan Jensen to punt for the first time. And Johnson gets away a wobbly kick. Coley lets it bounce, and it will roll out to the UM 32-yard line. Let's go back to Reese Davis.
Bob, halftime's not too far away. Among the topics we will address, Houston, we have O'Brien. We'll give you the latest on the Penn State coach and the potential move to the Houston Texans. Irish look very good in pinstripes against Rutgers this afternoon. We'll also show you how the Tar Heels bullied the Bearcats in a game that Lou Holtz said was not nearly as close as the score indicated. Mark's here, too. We'll see you in a bit.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. On a day where Louisville basketball fans are about as depressed as they could be as they lose the annual matchup to Kentucky, their football team has been terrific in the first half. This time, Morris, well protected, throws it up for grabs, and it's incomplete. Almost intercepted again. Stacy Coley had a chance to make a play on the ball, but Gerard Holloman had a better chance.
Yeah, we talked about the need to, you know, have some composure and not get caught up in the battle with Teddy Bridgewater. And Morris has every bit of an NFL arm, no question about it. But he can't force the football, can't get caught up, can't try things that aren't there. And he's had a couple of situations where the ball, you know, was going to be taken away. He's been fortunate that all of them haven't been picked off.
Delayed handoff to Dallas Crawford. And wow, is he planted back at the 28-yard line by Burgess again.
Did Burgess just spend the break watching Clowney? It's the second one that's really Clowney-esque.
I told you the first one was a poor man's Jadeveon Clowney.
Yeah, this one's even better.
That one, minus the helmet popping off, was about equal.
Wow. Now, do two of those equal one Clowney?
That's a good question. Third down and 15. Miami with 1 yard rushing in the first half.
Look at the way they're jumping around. Now, they've been effective in giving pressure by not lining up.
Wide receiver screen. Dorsett. No chance to get to the first down marker. But check that, Alan Hearns on the reception, so it will be Miami to punt again. And let's head down to Quinn.
Bob, Miami's offensive line has been in damage control this entire first half. Their offensive line coach, Art Kehoe, just in between recognition of the blitz, getting beaten their one-on-one assignments, and then he was under the impression that Louisville was doing a great job in those third and longs of timing the snap count and getting a running start. Miami's O-line, very big, but they've been beaten to the punch, and they haven't shown very good lateral quickness from field level.
So how do you mix that up?
Well, you know, first of all, it looks like what they've done is they've picked up on the fact that in shotgun, the right guard taps the center to tell him to snap the ball, and then the defensive line takes off when they see the tap. They time it and they go. So they may have to adjust that.
Maybe on the second tap, so you can get them to jump off on the first. They almost get to the punter again. And Pat O'Donnell sends it out of bounds up the right sideline. And this will go out to the 40-yard line for Louisville. It's only a 20-yard punt as O'Donnell hit a moon ball out of bounds. Wow, get close to all the action wherever you are with the new SportsCenter app. Blazing fast scores, the hottest news, highlights, analysis, and access to your favorite SportsCenter talent 24/7 via Twitter. You can download the new SportsCenter app by calling *SC from your phone. Well, that was a worst-case scenario for UM. Not only do you hand the ball back to Louisville with minimal time off the clock, but a shanked punt of only 20 yards gives Teddy Bridgewater the ball at his own 40-yard line. He still has two timeouts.
Yeah.
A minute 45 on the clock.
And when they bring pressure, it has not been getting home.
Four-man rush this time. Bridgewater to the sideline. Good coverage. Ladarius Gunter was in perfect position to break that one up.
Yeah, good to see him back out there. He got injured earlier this year. Missed a few ball games, but the break helped him get healthy and get back out there. You know, it's not over yet for Miami in this first half. They get a stop here. They have a chance to get the ball back.
Second down and 10 underneath for about 5 yards. Robert Clark makes the catch.
I might think about a timeout if I'm Miami.
Sets up third down and a long five close to six. Is that enough of a down and distance to spend a timeout here?
Yeah. It's risky, but I'd like to get the ball back if I'm on Miami and get try to get something on the board.
Well, Teddy Bridgewater's going hurry up. He escapes the pocket. Throws it to no man's land. Running under it and making the catch is Damian Copeland.
Oh, man.
What a play by Bridgewater on third down.
No way. No way. I mean, yeah, you get the fact that he's athletic and he can escape, but this touch and this perfectly dropped ball to Copeland, give me a break.
Now the bullet to Copeland at the sideline. He steps out of bounds.
Oh, man. You think he's going?
I can't think of many reasons for him not to.
Well,
let's put it that way.
I will say this. You know, Sean Watson said that he knows it's important to Teddy, you know, to hang around with the classmates he came in. Now, remember, Andrew Luck did the same thing.
Yep.
He said he wanted to graduate with the guys that he played with, and that brought him back.
Reaching up to pull it down is Parker.
Oh, I don't know, though. I don't know. Now, I know Sean Watson wants Bridgewater to talk to Peyton Manning and Andrew Luck about coming back and what the benefits are for that. But you see this play after play, you really start to wonder whether he would even think about it.
Now a touch to the end zone for the touchdown.
Wow.
And it's Michael Lee Harris, the old high school teammates at Miami Northwestern.
I mean, that's the highlight package. In the pocket, drops one perfectly. Gets out of the pocket, avoids the rush, drops one perfectly. Throws a dart when he has to. And there's no question about his skill set. The one thing I would question is, does he need to be a little bigger, a little heavier?
A shanked extra point. John Wallace makes 3 field goals but can't convert the point after, so Louisville settling for only a 20-point lead, 22-2. And Teddy Bridgewater, 19 of 26, 231 yards, 2 touchdowns, and looking every bit like the best quarterback in college football, at least in this first half.
Yeah, hard to find any flaws with him on that drive and most of this first half. I mean, that series, those last 3 plays, buying time, eyes in the back of his head, touch to Copeland, coming right back, drilling one in to Parker, and then finding Michael Lee Harris in the corner with another perfectly thrown ball.
If he comes back, you know Louisville's going to be a highly ranked team next season.
Yeah.
They'll also be in a conference that if they play at that top level, especially if they're undefeated, you can't take it away from them.
Yeah.
They'll have a chance to play for a national championship next year. You wonder if that's enough of a draw to get Teddy Bridgewater to come back for his senior season, play one more year, as you said, with these guys, but play in the ACC.
Keep in mind, he already has his degree.
Artie Burns brought down at the 28-yard line. And now Miami with only 23 seconds to go in the first half. They've got their timeouts. But I can't imagine they're going to get too frisky with their play calling here. No. What do they do to regroup in the locker room at halftime?
They have to find a way on offense to get Coley involved. I mean, he is critical to their offense. The screen game, getting him some touches, and they haven't been able to do that. So they have to find a way to get him involved. They haven't had enough touches for Hearns either, but all that is pass protection. Morris has been under duress the entire first half. They've got to find a way to give him a little bit more protection.
Well, this might get them to at least use one of their timeouts as Dallas Crawford brings it all the way out to the 42-yard line. And Al Golden will call a timeout. You bust a run up the middle for 14 yards, and now that changes things in how you approach these last 17 seconds.
Yeah, I'm just still not convinced that they've had enough time to handle the pass protection issue. I think they need that halftime to get that settled. They've had some missed assignments when they've gone the pass pro, whether it's the back or which way the line moves. And Morris has had some problems.
Well, the defensive front for Louisville tonight, they've changed the line of scrimmage, and they have put a ton of pressure on Stephen Morris.
Yeah, that's just sacks there. You see the three, not including the pressure and the times that he's had to move out of the pocket.
So the Canes still with two timeouts, but averaging less than 3 yards per play. And Morris sets up the screen. Dallas Crawford tripped up. That's a loss of three. And it looks like Al Golden will spend another timeout rather than just let the game go to halftime.
I'll
check that he won. It looked as if he was signaling timeout to the official, but thought better of it. So it will be a 22-2 Louisville lead at halftime. Let's go down to Quinn.
Coach, what has been most challenging for your offensive line?
We're not getting a running game going right now, Quinn. We got to settle in, find two or three runs that we can count on, and we got to stay out of those long third and longs. We got to get it. We're just getting, we can't protect them in those situations.
Yeah, when you regroup as an overall team, what will you focus on?
I'm just going to tell them to settle down. We put the defense in a lot of bad spots right there. Defense was playing really well. We just got to settle down. Just, you know, scratch our way, claw our way back into this thing one step at a time.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
All right, Quint, thanks very much. It's a 22-2 lead as Teddy Bridgewater throws a couple of first-half touchdown passes. It's time for Reese Davis and our halftime report. And Rod Gilmore here in Orlando. Quinn Kesnick will join us in just a moment. If you wanted a resume tape for the first pick in the NFL draft, you saw it in the first half. Teddy Bridgewater, he made every throw imaginable, and his wide receivers made plays for him as well.
Yeah, he kind of put his skills on display for you, particularly late in the second half. He showed you everything you needed to see in the quarterback. Touch, pocket passing, looking off of safety, creating some space, extending a play, buying some time, and then dropping one in perfectly to Copeland like this, and then coming right back, dropping another one in the corner to his receiver, Harris. And then on the other side, how about the star, Marcus Harris? I mean, he just comes out and makes play after play. Marcus Smith, I'm sorry, makes a sack strip, almost picks it up himself there. They had three sacks in that first half, but Smith was dominant on the defense, and then Bridgewater dominant on the offense.
Well, speaking of dominant, look at the first half stats brought to you by Mobile One Extended Performance. 2.6 yards per first down play, only 83 yards of total offense in the first half for Miami, as opposed to 280 yards of total offense in the first half for Louisville.
Well, I think if you're Miami second half, and you heard Al Golden talk about running the ball, I don't think they can run it until they protect the quarterback. I think they have to throw to open up the run. I don't think they're going to line up on first down when they get the ball and just pound it away against that defense.
And to make matters worse, Louisville starts the second half with the ball, and they will start with pretty good field position at their own 30-yard line, but we've got a flag thrown on the return.
On the return, holding number 31 of the receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Well, that will certainly help Miami, as that will back Louisville up. Let's go down to Quinn Kesnick.
Our biggest challenge is not relaxing. This is what Charlie Strong told me. He says, we've got to finish. looking forward to playing our best second half of the season after following up the first half. I'll tell you, watching Coach Strong in this first half is the most emotional I've ever seen him, flying up and down the sideline, cheering on players. I was at last year's Sugar Bowl. He was not as emotional as he is tonight.
Well, there's history between the two programs, obviously, as maybe some of the emotion of all the Miami kids that Charlie Strong has is spilling over for the head coach. Dominique Brown on first down. That's a gain of about three. And Rod, we have had so many conversations about Teddy Bridgewater and his future. Charlie Strong's future, he's tried to put it to bed. But is he going to stay at Louisville long term?
I think so. I think he's here for a while. I don't think he's a candidate at Texas. You know, he's pretty loyal to Louisville for giving him the opportunity to become a head coach. And I think unless that Florida job opens sometime in the future, I don't think there'll be much talk about him heading anywhere.
Unbalanced line and a run to Dominique Brown on second down for only about a yard. So here's a chance for Miami on third down to get a stop and a three and out to start off the second half. It'll be third down and a long five.
Yeah, and it's huge for them to come up with a play here. And Teddy Bridgewater has hurt them on third down, buying time and also just drilling those short passes to get just the first down. Now, do you pressure him again? I mean, they've struggled when they pressured him. I think they'll probably play coverage and try and flood areas.
It's Devontae Parker and Eli Rogers stacked to the near side left. Bridgewater looks that way. That's a first down to Eli Rogers. A gain of seven.
You know, they went pressure again, and who did Teddy Bridgewater turn to? His high school teammate from Miami, Eli Rogers. You'll see the pressure come. They'll bring six guys. They pick it up. Great pickup in the backfield there by Dominique Brown. And there was enough time for Bridgewater to find Rogers.
Swing pass in the left flat. Here comes another first down. Dominique Brown flared out, and Teddy Bridgewater found him.
I go back to Sean Watson for a minute, the offensive coordinator. He doesn't get enough credit for the way that he brought along Teddy Bridgewater. He started Teddy as a freshman, teaching him defense. And he didn't teach him the offensive plays until he learned how to recognize defenses. Now, I think that's phenomenal. That's a great way to go to make sure your guy understands what he's seeing out there.
Bridgewater off a play-action fake. Down the sideline. Coming back to make the catch up against the sideline is Parker, but out of bounds. It will be second down and 10.
Yeah. I don't know that he intentionally underthrew that one. I thought Parker was beyond the guy and that he had to let it fly. I think he underthrew it. Parker came back to make a great play on it, but he was out of bounds.
Second down, it's Brown. Buried by Olson Pierre, so we'll see what Sean Watson has in store for us on third down and about 10.
Well, he says he doesn't worry about pressure with Teddy Bridgewater, particularly on third down, because they drill him all the time. That's what he was brought up with, because this defense at Louisville, they do pressure most of the time anyway.
Bridgewater almost flawless on third down in this game, and that's been a theme for him all season. A 90 QBR on third down. Four-man rush, they set up the screen. Coming back to make the catch is James Quick. Weaves his way for a first down in plus territory. Miami couldn't find the true freshman from Louisville. Al-Qadeem Muhammad eventually made the tackle, but not after a gain of 13.
Yeah, give credit to Quick on that one. He made that first down happen. This is all about yards after the catch. They get the screen pass, but watch how many guys he makes miss, and then he drags one to get the first down. Miami just can't come with a game-changing play yet.
Fourth first down completion for Teddy Bridgewater on a third down play. He'll roll out, wide open, the tight end Gerald Christian, and he's close to another first down. Denzel Perryman was on the far sideline to bump out Christian, but that's a gain of 9 yards.
Yeah, and nothing seems to be working for Miami right now. I mean, that first down, they brought a heavy blitz, didn't get home. And Teddy bought time and got the playoff. They need a takeaway. They need to find a way to get the ball back and get some momentum.
Another first down run. Dominique Brown powers his way to the 40-yard line, or rather down to the 30-yard line. Louisville lost basketball-wise earlier today to Kentucky, but that does not put much of a damper on 2013 for their sports program as a whole. They win a BCS game in the Sugar Bowl. Their women's basketball team shocks everyone's favorite to win the championship in Baylor. Their men's team wins the national championship. Then in the Super Regional of the College World Series, they knock off Vanderbilt and go to Omaha. And now here they are in another bowl game, taking on a future conference opponent in Miami and beating Miami up to this point in a way that no team has so far this season, including Florida State. Bridgewater, high throw, called in by Brown, takes a hit, but picks up 8.
Everything seems to be falling into place. But you got to come up with something if you're Miami. You cannot give up a score here. Certainly not a touchdown. All house blitz. Roll the dice.
That time Miami able to get a tackle for loss. Armbrister at the bottom of the pile. So it's third down and about 4, close to 5.
10 different receivers. He's been on his game tonight. But this is your stand if you're Miami. Defensively, you got to make a play. You got to get a sack. You got to get a takeaway. You got to have something here.
It's the 12th play of a drive that has eaten up almost half of the third quarter. Here comes a blitz. Bridgewater coolly unloads another first down. Inside the 10. How about the end zone? Samaris Perry. A little dump off on third down, takes it the distance.
John Watson, the offensive coordinator, anticipated the blitz, went to the screen pass, and Perry finished that off.
Teddy Bridgewater just broke Brian Brohm's school record for most touchdown passes in a season. 31 touchdown passes for Teddy Bridgewater against only 4 interceptions. He's over 300 yards tonight, and Miami's defense is getting dominated by Louisville. Plays, and it is a crushing right now by Louisville against Miami.
It's almost becoming a coronation for Teddy Bridgewater.
Stacy Coley to the 29-yard line. When we return, Quint Kesnick will be talking with the coach divided. Howard Snow, 6-0, career record in bowl games. The 1983 Eddie Robinson Coach of the Year. And, of course, he is on hand at tonight's game watching both of his old programs go up against one another here in Orlando. Stephen Morris to throw on first down. Long throw to the outside. That's bobbled and incomplete. And it goes from bad to worse for Miami as we go down to Quint.
Coach, you don't have your hat on anymore that says a coach divided. But first of all, who are you rooting for tonight?
Well, I'm rooting for both teams, obviously. As my hat indicated, I'm a coach for both of these teams. And Beverly and I are so thrilled to have been invited to come to this game. My cup runs over because of being associated with these two great football programs.
Yeah, what's it been like for you, Coach, to watch Miami's program? You won a national title, but then they were a nationally dominant program, and the same with Louisville. They've really turned the corner for a program. What's it been like for you?
Well, my life has gone ahead. You know, coaching for Florida Atlantic University up until 2 years ago, but Miami was my first head coaching job. And to be able to bring that to the national championships in 5 years was so rewarding. And then to go back home to Louisville, Kentucky, and to get it going again was so thrilling. And now as I watch both teams, I feel like this is a neighborhood brawl with my children from Miami and my grandchildren from Louisville. Most of them from the state of Florida are having a brawl right here in the heart of Florida.
As Miami coach, 1983 national championship, what's the one memory that sticks out from that championship season?
The grit and determination of a whole lot of players and coaches to lose the opening ball game to our major rival Florida, 28-3, I believe. Start a freshman, redshirt freshman quarterback. When Kosar go back to the practice field, win 11 games in a row, and then to get a chance to play the greatest team of the decade or more, and come out of there with a win in the 50th anniversary game of the Orange Bowl. That was a game that started the dynasty that lasted for 15 years, the game that propelled football in the state of Florida, and maybe even the nation.
Thank you, Coach. Congratulations on your work at both schools.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Bob.
All right, Quint, thanks very much. Well, the first of his two stops, finally getting a little bit of rhythm going on offense as Miami has it with a backwards pass. That's a live ball. It rolls out of bounds all the way back to the UM 36-yard line. Just when Miami gets a little bit of momentum going on offense, they kill themselves with a loss of 19.
Yeah, and you saw that ball was thrown from about the 48, the plus, back to the negative 49. That was a backwards pass. They're trying to run a screen pass.
Maybe they wanted Allen Hurns to throw the ball.
Well, that only works if the screen pass game has been working for you. And the screen pass game hasn't been working.
Check that Dorsett. It seemed as if they were setting blockers up out in front. Maybe it was a trick play. As Morris drops back on second down and long. Wide open, though, is Clive Walford. He's got a first down. How about that? Second down and 29, and you pick up 32.
Again, you know, he is a talented receiving tight end. Had 30 catches this season. He'll be coming across from the left of the screen. You'll see him cross the middle now, right behind the linebackers. And he's got really soft hands. He had a chance to come out early if he wants to.
And off to Gus Edwards. He's down to the 26-yard line. That's a gain of 6.
You know, going back to Clive Walford, the tight end, he said that he will decide after the game whether to come out. Some indication that he's likely to leave. He does have a young son. Some family responsibilities which might push him to leave.
He didn't play football till his senior year of high school. He was a high school basketball player. So still learning the game. Gus Edwards. Spun down. After a gain of one, it'll make it third down and three. And what you'd have to think at this point is all four down territory down at this end for Miami.
Yep.
Even in the third quarter, down 29-2.
Yep.
If they stall here, can you imagine fourth and short, they'd attempt a field goal?
You know, I'd run Edwards. I like him, and he's the future for them in the backfield. You watch him on tape. He's a big, strong, fast guy, and he's going to be their guy next year, I believe.
There he is on third down. And he is short.
You know, I'd run him again. Look, you care about the way you play and the way you finish this game. Don't worry about the score right now. I mean, you're setting a tone and an attitude, and I think this offensive line needs that attitude. And Edwards needs this work.
This is fourth down and a solid 1.5,
yeah,
almost 2 yards. You wonder if this is get Stephen Morris rolling out, trying to throw the football.
I would run it and say, we're going to be tough.
They get them to jump off sides.
I mean, one thing that Miami's got to have is they've got to be better up front, and you have to send the message. They've got some young guys up there.
Offside. Defense number 92 with contact. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
They have some young guys, and you have to push the physicality. Flowers is only a sophomore. Yeah, he's going to be back. They have a couple juniors up there that'll be back. And had they not picked it up with that penalty, I would have had him run it one more time.
Here's Edwards for about a yard on first down. Brandon Dunn, who just jumped off sides, makes the tackle. And now we've got an injured Louisville player.
And that's Burgess. And
slow,
boy,
to get up.
He's had a couple of big hits tonight.
He'll stay in the game, though.
Yeah, saw the thumbs up there.
Now it's Dallas Crawford in as the tailback. Maybe a yard on second down. Sets up third down and at least eight.
Again, as you pointed out, two downs. Now the question is, can they protect Stephen Morris? In every passing situation, he's been under duress.
Play clock down to 10. And the game clock continues to melt away. It's a drive approaching 6 minutes for Miami. Morris, long throw to the outside, nowhere near Stacy Coley. Now it's fourth down and 9.
Yeah, you can't kick the field goal here. I mean, am I wrong?
The only possible logic behind kicking the field goal, you bring yourself within 24. That's a three-possession game,
no,
but you're right. You have to go for it.
I mean, this is about your mental attitude and approach to the game.
You can still see that Louisville defensive front moving around. No one puts their hand on the ground. And it's been hard all night for Stephen Morris to decipher the look that he's going to get.
Yeah, and they try to time the snap.
Now he's got
to
call timeout with the play clock winding all the way down. That's been a theme tonight.
Timeout, Miami.
The timeout, late third quarter. Here comes a blitz. Unchecked up the middle. Hard to believe. That's the American Defensive Player of the Year, Marcus Smith again. Another huge red zone sack by Smith. And again, Miami leaves him unblocked.
Well, check out right here. See the right guard? Watch him tap the center. When he taps the center, now Louisville knows the snap's coming. They've timed that all day. And that's been a problem. And now, if there's one guy that you have to block, it's Smith. And he's unblocked there. So we heard Quinn Kesnick say earlier that there was some concern about timing out that snap. Well, there you saw it.
18 and a half tackles for loss this season. 14 and a half sacks on the year for Marcus Smith. Bridgewater, home run ball down the sideline, tipped away. He underthrew Devontae Parker, who had a step on Ladarius Gunter. Let's take a look back at our Buick drive recap. And Louisville's last drive, like many that have preceded them tonight, effective mix. And Teddy Bridgewater looking like the best quarterback in college football.
It was a heavy mix of screen passes, and it was a long, consuming drive. Resulted in Terry's touchdown and a 29-2 Louisville advantage.
Straight blast, Dominique Brown. Shayon Green made the tackle for Miami, but that's a gain of about seven. Sets up third down and three.
Yeah, and Bridgewater's numbers tonight have overwhelmed Miami's entire offense. He's got more rushing yards by himself than Miami. Only four yards rushing for Miami.
Another third down completion for Teddy Bridgewater. He just keeps on spreading it around. That time it's Michael Lee Harris with a third down conversion. And two of the nation's most physical teams collide in the granddaddy of them all. The 100th Rose Bowl game presented by Vizio. Number 4, Michigan State. Number 5, Stanford. Looking for their second consecutive Rose Bowl title. Coverage begins New Year's Day at 4:30 Eastern on ESPN.
Yeah, just really sad for Max Boa, who's not going to be able to play, suspended by Michigan State. I mean, can you imagine spending your entire career hoping to get to that game, and then you're suspended?
Dominique Brown again. This time a gain of two. And one big reason why Max Boa will be missed. How about what that Michigan State defense is going to face in Tyler Gaffney?
Yeah, he was playing baseball a year ago. He was actually at the Rose Bowl last year watching Stephon Taylor run the ball. Now this year, Gaffney gets a chance to be the man in the Rose Bowl, and he'll go up against Jeremy Langford, who, you know, got better and better as the season went along for Sparty. I mean, he was a guy that was just learning to become a running back. By the end of the year, he was almost as good as anyone in the Big Ten running the football.
Play action for Bridgewater. Wide open again.
Young was so concerned, so adamant about playing well. I mean, I think he was stung by the fact that after they lost to Central Florida, there was a lot of criticism of the program, a lot of criticism of the soft schedule. And he was looking forward to being back on the national stage and wanted to have that shot.
Well, it certainly helps when you've got Teddy Bolgame as your quarterback, because he is more dominant this year against Miami than he was last year against Florida in the Sugar Bowl. And he is earning the nickname Teddy Bolgame. Last year, he earned nationwide attention for a dominant performance against Florida in the Sugar Bowl. He's been better tonight against Miami.
That's pretty impressive. 5 TDs, 1 pick. Look at that, 47 completions in those two ball games. There's Sean Watson, offensive coordinator, the guy who's become one of the 4 or 5 most important people in Teddy Bridgewater's life, according to Teddy.
Check down again, Sonoris Perry. Inside the 10, first and goal, Louisville. Well, Teddy Bridgewater has that nucleus that he talks about, and there is the epicenter of that nucleus. Rose Murphy, his mother, a breast cancer survivor. That had a major impact on Teddy Bridgewater. His relationship with his mom, his relationship with Sean Watson, his relationship with Charlie Strong. They're going to have a lot to say about what his plans are for next year.
No doubt. Since Watson has become a father figure and Charlie Strong a very, very close friend.
Perry on a cutback to about the 7-yard line.
And while this has been Teddy's show tonight, don't sleep on Miami going forward. They're sitting on what looks like a top five recruiting class for next season, and they're bringing back a team that's pretty young.
Well, now Al Golden can recruit based on what he ought to be able to recruit on.
Well, he knows.
Top 40 institutions, yep. South Florida, the history, the tradition of Miami. There's no cloud hanging over the program's head anymore as Bridgewater drops the throw. Again, it's underneath. And about 2 yards shy of the end zone, Damian Copeland is brought down.
And Golden knows his scholarship limitation for a limited amount of time. He knows what he can do. And Louisville, remember, this was a little bit of a recruiting battle game. They've got 37 players on their roster from the state of Florida, 25 from the city of Miami.
Timeout called by Louisville. 360 passing yards on the night for Teddy Bridgewater. And they're inside the five when we return. And then made a verbal commitment to LSU before landing at Louisville, beating Kentucky in his third game as a freshman. What a performance as a sophomore last year in the Sugar Bowl. The upset of Florida, 21-3 as a starter in his last two seasons, and looking very much like he will go 22-3 and disappoint another Florida team in a bowl game, as last year beats Florida in the Sugar Bowl. This year dominant to this point over Miami in the Russell Athletic Bowl. Bob Wischusen, Rod Gilmore, Quint Kesmick here in Orlando. And after the timeout, it's third down and goal. Dominique Brown, shy of the goal line. It'll be fourth down from just outside the one. The offense looks like it's going to stay on the field.
I was going to say, I'm waiting for the field goal team. But there is none.
Well, should you fail to punch it in, what has Miami shown you offensively to make you fear they're going to go 99 yards?
This is just about adding it on. This is not about what your defense can do. This is about just putting the nail in the coffin.
Fourth and goal. Play action and a rollout for Bridgewater. He'll tuck it under. Pylon into the end zone for the touchdown.
Seen him run it a bit, and now you get to see him celebrate with his teammates, and the fans are just chanting his name now.
The Cardinals have scored on 7 of their 9 drives tonight. 3 straight touchdown drives. And this is a blowout no one saw coming.
I think he's been having a lot of fun. You think so? Think he's gone?
To that together we are Ram. Hurry in for a great deal on the Ram Big Finish event. And Marathon, fueling the American spirit.
If this is indeed Teddy Bridgewater waving goodbye, this has been quite a goodbye to college football tonight. His team is on top 36-2 in the Russell Athletic Bowl.
Yeah, as good as he's been, can't overlook how dominating that defense has been. They have smothered Miami's offense completely.
Another short kick that will bounce. Taken on a hop by Artie Burns. And he gets down the sideline. Knocked out of bounds by the kicker, John Wallace. Out to the 45-yard line goes Burns, and two programs making their BCS debuts. On New Year's night, it's the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl. Bryce Petty and the nation's leading offense, number six Baylor, will go up against Blake Bortles, who somehow edged out Teddy Bridgewater for the American Player of the Year. Number 15, UCF, will aim to complete their best season ever. Coverage begins New Year's night, 8:30 Eastern on ESPN.
Hey, a lot of folks like Bortles better than Bridgewater, and it's not clear whether he's coming out.
Morris finds Allen Hurns.
You got to like that throw. I mean, that is an NFL throw. It's good to see Stephen Morris healthy. He played the entire season pretty much with a bad ankle that affected him just an awful lot.
Long throw down the sideline, intended for Walford. He's bumped out by Gerard Holloman. Aerial coverage of tonight's game provided by Goodyear. Everything Goodyear has learned making tires that go the distance inspires what they roll into yours. Goodyear, more driven. Well, speaking of Stephen Morris, on our big board that Todd McShay and all the guys from ScoutSync put together on ESPN.com, they have Morris, who is a senior, so he will be going to the Senior Bowl and then heading to the draft as the number 12 overall quarterback. Gus Edwards plows his way inside the 35 down to about the Louisville 34. And at the start of the season, he was higher up that list,
yeah.
Right? He was more thought of as like a late second, maybe
yeah.
early third round pick. Right now, our guys on ESPN.com project him to be more a mid to late fourth round pick, but still a solid middle of the draft quarterback.
Keep
prospect.
In mind, some of the guys rated ahead of him has significant knee injuries.
Right.
And would you spend a high draft pick on someone who's coming off a knee injury, or do you take a Stephen Morris?
Morris tries to set up the screen. There's no one there. And now it's fourth down and two. Calvin Pryor came on a safety blitz and pressured Stephen Morris. The Louisville sideline looking for intentional grounding, but it looked as if that was just a miscommunication. Wide open Dallas Crawford. That's a fourth down conversion for Miami.
That's a really good read. Really good read. He saw the pressure coming from the right side with Calvin Pryor and threw right where the blitz came from.
Louisville blitz on first down. Morris bullets one inside the five. Stacy Coley down to the 2-yard line. He got popped by Hakeem Smith, but held onto the football.
Yeah, it's a good catch and really, really a strong throw. Fine throw by Stephen Morris. One hit, steps into it. There's no denying his arm talent.
We've got an injury timeout on the field. Looks like Marcus Smith is down for Louisville. Well, check that. It's not Marcus Smith. It's Sheldon Rankins who's down. So the big defensive tackle from Covington, Georgia. It looks like they're looking at his shin or left ankle.
And he's been part of a rotation in that defensive line that's done a really good job tonight, really harassing that Miami offensive line.
And out there helping up Shelton Rankins is Clint Hurt, the associate head coach, recruiting coordinator for Louisville. And unfortunately, Rankins not able to put any weight on that foot at all. So we start to wind this clock down, and you start to wind down that hourglass towards Teddy Bridgewater announcing what his decision would be. Who knows? He might say in the locker room after tonight's game what his decision is going to be. He indicated to us he might let a little time go by, sit down with that nucleus and decide.
Well, he told us yesterday that, yeah, he would have some time. He might think about it or he might announce afterwards. Now, we know that people close to him want him to take a little time. They want him to talk to some guys like Peyton Manning, Andrew Luck, and talk about what it's like to come back. Are you enjoying college? Because there's a lot of pressure for him to go.
And off Gus Edwards. Finally, Miami gets in the end zone.
You can see the power that Edwards has. 225-pound freshman. Staten Island, New York. Cottonville High School Pirates. Big-time recruit.
And James Coley, their offensive coordinator, told us that he's the most talented guy that they have. He's a power runner, but he's also their fastest running back. And in the absence of Duke Johnson, his role has certainly expanded. But it makes it just a little bit more attractive on the scoreboard to be a UM fan. Louisville still on top. Teddy Bridgewater back up off the bench with his helmet on. A moment ago, it looked like his night might be done. Let's see if he goes back out there with his teammates.
Yeah, I would think he would be. Or maybe they give him one more series, but
Robert Clark runs it out from at least 6 or 7 yards deep and does not come near the 20-yard line.
Yeah, he's going to come back out, it looks like, for another series. And I tell you, he can create. If you go back to that Cincinnati game at the end of the year, watch him create this play. Spin around, whoop, finds Copeland, touchdown. And what did he do tonight? Almost the exact same play. Spin around, buy some time. Who's he find? Copeland. You think they've done that a few times in practice?
Doesn't look like the kind of play you rehearse.
I think he knows where Copeland will be. They know the little scramble drill.
Damian Copeland, a fifth-year senior from Bradenton, Florida. So another one of those weapons for Louisville from down here in the Sunshine State, as is Teddy Bridgewater. Dominique Brown.
All
right. He's from Cincinnati. He spins out close to the 20-yard line.
I'm going to make my one case for Teddy coming back to Louisville. I mean, he already has his degree. Here's the case. One, play with the guys you came in with, graduate with them, enjoy them one more year.
Andrew Luck-esque.
Yep, and also get bigger. Add some muscle, get ready for the NFL, because he's a little bit under 200 pounds, and the successful guys at the next level, you know, are a little bit healthier, a little bigger, a little stronger.
He is 6'3", but he's slender.
Very slender. Built more like RG3 than Andrew Luck.
Another connection with Devontae Parker for another first down. And Devontae Parker, the Louisville native, gains 12 more and adds to his totals. He's up to 8 catches for 115 yards and a touchdown.
Did I persuade you?
Well, let me add on to that as we're trying, I'm sure, for all the Louisville fans that are still watching us back after they watched their basketball team lose to Kentucky today. They're going to be grasping at whatever straw they can to make themselves feel better about a sports day that hurts on the hardwood. But boy, has this been a dominant performance on the gridiron here in the Russell Athletic Bowl. Is there something to be said for playing a full season in the ACC? On a rollout, here's Bridgewater. Using the stiff arm, stays on his feet, and scrambles out of bounds for a gain of about 3.
Yeah, he just continues to show you his athleticism. For people who thought he was simply a pocket passer and couldn't run, couldn't move, I mean, just watch this. I mean, this is a guy who asked his coach at one point, when he didn't think he was going to be a quarterback early on, hey, can I move the wide receiver? He's got some skills.
Good decision.
Yeah.
That they made ultimately.
Yeah.
I think quarterback, that might be his position.
I do want to hear your other point as to why he ought to come back.
High throw up the seam, incomplete as the blitz came over the head of Michael Lee Harris. And Bridgewater a little slow to get up. Well, the point I was making was, now he's dominating an ACC team tonight. Last year, he was tremendous against an SEC team in the Sugar Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's enough. But to play a full season against higher-level competition prepares you more for the NFL. And obviously, with all due respect to the American Conference, there's more NFL talent to the ACC than the American Conference.
Yeah.
Does that add on at all?
It's a little bit. It helps a little, but I think the other factor that might weigh into that is, what does Bortles do at Central Florida? I mean, if he comes out and the consensus is that Teddy's not the top quarterback, you start looking at the draft order, maybe you think, I don't know. Maybe I don't like where I'm going to go.
Another catch made by Parker. And it's Teddy Bridgewater throwing it down the chimney again.
Yeah, and there's another issue. Does Parker come back? I mean, he's a guy who can leave, and he's outstanding. I mean, look at him go up and make this play. He catches almost everything with his hands. He has a great radius for making catches.
It's been a fun night. When you throw for 400 yards, which is what Teddy Bridgewater has just done.
Yeah, but you know what? Stop throwing now. Just stop throwing.
And they keep it on the ground now with Dominique Brown. Well, here's the night for Teddy Bridgewater. He has put up 400 passing yards, and Miami with only 160 passing yards and 174 total yards.
Yeah, I just don't know he needs to, you know, throw it anymore or be in there much longer. I mean, let him come out of the ball game. Let the fans serenade him. No need to take any more chances with hits and the like.
Another strike, and that might be a targeting call. The Miami players are all arguing. But Tyrone Cornelius came over, and it looks like that may be a targeting foul. Ryan Hubbell, the tight end, the intended receiver, as we take another look.
Well, you know, anytime you get
a foul, targeting with the crown of the helmet, defense number 31, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down. By rule, he's ejected from the game.
And Bill Lemagne, longtime Big Ten official that 3 years ago was the referee in the national championship game, kind enough to spend the night with us here in the booth. You haven't been that busy, but this is now one that they will go to replay. What are your thoughts? Targeting here, the right call?
Yeah, Bob, this is an automatic replay review with the targeting and disqualification foul. We've got a defenseless player. He's in the process of trying to receive the pass. The defender comes in. He's high to the head neck area. I think we had two flags on the play, and we should be good on this call.
Is that launching, crown of the helmet, a little bit of both?
Rolling on the field is confirmed. Number 31, disqualified from the game.
Launching is a kind of a red flag. It's something you look for that will lead to it, but it in itself isn't the problem. The problem is when you thrust up, when you leave the ground, you're putting yourself in a position that you're going to go higher on the defender.
It doesn't have to be the crown of the helmet when you're talking about a defenseless player. You're talking about anything that's above the numbers there, correct?
Exactly correct, Rad. The defenseless player, anything to the head neck area.
Yep.
Well, that will end the Miami career of Tyrone Cornelius as the senior has been ejected. And if a player is not a senior, is coming back for another season next year, a junior or below that doesn't go to the NFL, if he's ejected in the second half of the bowl game, he would be suspended for the first half of next year's first regular season game, I believe. Doesn't the suspension carry forward to next season?
For that rule, it like the fighting rule, it carries over to your next game if it's in the second half of the ball game.
And again, the policy is we want to lower the target, the striking zone. We want players to hit lower and not up high.
You know, it's a microsecond of a decision thing, but we're trying to get the players to play the game lower.
Mm-hmm.
And that it's really a conscious decision. And these players, we know they have the ability to make that decision and play the game with a lower target zone.
A broken play there that Teddy Bridgewater simply took a knee. So it will be second down and 13 for Louisville as Teddy Bridgewater still in the game to possibly pad his statistics. He's got a 400-yard night working to go along with three touchdowns. He has been flawless.
Is the fact that he's in a clue that maybe he's done after tonight?
Maybe. Long throw to the 20-yard line, outside the numbers to Robert Clark. And a reminder that if you'd like to see the exclusive coverage of the 2013 Russell Athletic Bowl Trophy Ceremony presented by Capital One, we'll have that for you on ESPN3 as soon as we wrap things up here in Orlando. And that will be the hardware that the Cardinals will take back home to Louisville. Screen to Perry, and this time he's brought down. It will be fourth down and 7, and another opportunity to try a field goal, and it looks like Matthew Nakatani will come out to attempt this one as Teddy Bridgewater comes off the field, perhaps for the last time as a member of Louisville. Tanny from 37, and that comes up short, may have been deflected at the line, so it remains 36-9 Louisville, and we expect to hear from Teddy Bridgewater before we're off the air tonight.
Bring up in a bit, guys.
All right, Reese, thanks very much, and hopefully that game a bit more competitive than the Russell Athletic Bowl has been tonight, because Teddy Bridgewater made this game a blowout early. As Louisville has dominated Miami, the Canes have the football back at their own 20-yard line. Bob Wischusen, Rod Gilmore, Quinn Kesnick here in Orlando. And before we are off the air, as we said, and head to the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl, we expect to have a chance to talk to Teddy Bridgewater. As Stephen Morris sails one over the head of Alan Hearns, and Teddy Bridgewater is certainly tonight's player of the game, brought to you by Capital One.
He had a big night, and as did that defense. I mean, clearly Teddy's night was overwhelming. Marcus Smith did a nice job on the other side with his quarterback pressures and sacks. That defense dominated this Miami offense, but Teddy Bridgewater was clearly the story tonight.
A drop by Bo Sandlin.
Well, despite the outcome of this game, it clearly was a good season for Miami. This is the first bowl game they've had since, I believe, 06. They're now out from under all the NCAA and self-imposed sanctions that would have kept them away from bowl games in the future. And as we said before, they're sitting on what looks like a top five recruiting class for next year, according to ESPN.com Recruiting Nation.
Morris throws one up for grabs on third down and long. Pursued again by Marcus Smith. It'll be fourth down and 10. And for Miami, I mean, Teddy Bridgewater, obviously the story tonight. And we'll see what there is in his future, but you talk about the bright future for Al Golden and his program. When you get blown out in the bowl game like this, how hard is it to put in perspective in the big picture what this season really is about now for Miami, now that they have the NCAA sanctions and scandal put well behind them?
It's hard initially because everybody focuses on the last game. But what they've done over this season and where they're positioned for next year is a really good thing for the year.
And up 36-9, it looks like Teddy Bridgewater will go back out with the offense for Louisville, but maybe this is an opportunity to give him a curtain call. Let's see if Charlie Strong opts to leave him in for the entire drive, or if he plays a play or two and then gets a salute.
Well, maybe that's it. The fans are already standing saluting him. Maybe he'll hand it off once or twice and then come off the field.
And he can't do it alone. Terrific pass protection tonight. Great play calling by Sean Watson. Every receiver at some point or another tonight has made a play for Teddy Bridgewater.
Great catch. And yards after the catch.
I don't know. You could say the same about the UM wide receivers and how much they've helped out their quarterback. Play action for Bridgewater. Fires one to the sideline, and coming back to make the catch is Damian Copeland.
There's an example of exactly what you were talking about. I mean, that's a great catch on the sideline, keeping his feet in bounds, and we've seen on the other side Miami miss a couple of those opportunities. You know, maybe it's just me, though. I just don't know that you need Teddy to keep throwing the football here. I think you run it and get out of here and let him have his standing ovation. I'm too critical, huh?
There's a handoff to Brandon Radcliffe, who gains a yard up the middle. And that will take us inside of 3 minutes to go, and we'll see if Bridgewater finishes off this drive. He's only 2 yards shy of his career high for passing. He's at 422 yards, 424 is his career high. So the party goes on in the stands with his family. There's his mom.
Party on the stand, in the stands, party on the field too.
I wouldn't think that would be something that Charlie Strong and Sean Watson would be that aware of, but here he is throwing the football. Pocket collapses, and he falls forward for a gain of a yard and a half. And you're right, exposing him to these hits right now in a 36-9 game with 2.5 minutes to go. You wonder why.
I just don't see the value in it.
A gain of two.
If it were me, I'd be running this football, running that clock, and if I had to do it, kick the ball back over to Miami and get out of here and go to the celebration and all that kind of good stuff.
Third down and seven in stride. He finds Copeland, and there is a new career high. Or check that, Eli Rogers, a new career high passing for Teddy Bridgewater. And by a mile. And now you'll get the curtain call. Are these hugs goodbye?
I don't know, they're pretty emotional, huh? Hey, I made my case for him coming back. And I don't think I persuaded you.
Just trying to run the clock out. It's a fumble inside the 5-yard line by Sonoris Perry. And it might be a recovery by Miami. No, Louisville holds onto the football. And really, at this point, all the Cardinals have to do is take a knee and end the game. 47 seconds to go. They could have taken a knee there.
Yeah.
And ended the game.
This is not quite like the Washington State, Colorado State game where they could have taken a knee, Washington State, and didn't, ended up losing. They don't take a knee here. They don't lose. Maybe they rub it in a little bit more. Here's the victory formation. Well done.
And that will make it official. 36-9. Louisville dominates Miami in the Russell Athletic Bowl. And it might be the final night in a Cardinal uniform for Teddy Bridgewater. Who knows what is in store for Charlie Strong as well. We promised you would hear from Teddy Bridgewater. We'll do that now with Quinn Kesman.
Teddy, congratulations. You run out of the tunnel tonight. What were your expectations?
I just wanted to come out here and just leave it all on the field for my teammates. You know, we wanted to end the season on a high note. You know, Miami's a good opponent, and you know, what a way to go out against a hometown school. So that was my thought, my mindset.
How do you best describe your performance?
You know, it was one of my best. And I left everything on the field. I did the little things that coach wanted me to do. But I couldn't have done it all without my teammates. You know, the offensive line, the running backs, wide receivers, and the defense played good.
What emotions are you dealing with right now?
I'm just very excited. You know, there's no greater feeling than seeing your hometown school fans walk out of the stadium. And, you know, that there just meant a lot to me.
Did I just hear you say, what a way to go out? Or is there a decision you're ready to make right now?
Well, you know, the way things went tonight, you know, now I'll sit down, talk with my mom, talk with the coaches, and we'll just go from there.
Teddy, congratulations. Good luck to you in the future. I know you got a lot of hands to shake right now.
Thank you.
Well, Teddy Bridgewater, if that